Director of the Ministry of Culture and Tourism is the authorized government body for intangible cultural heritage. Turkey is one of 5 out of 181 signatories. It has 18 elements registered on UNESCO intangible cultural heritage, the ones related to music, Mevlevi Sema ceremony, Aşıklık tradition, Nevruz multinational celebrations, traditional sohbet meetings, Urfa Sıra geceleri, Semah Alevi Bektaşi ritual, Hıdrelle spring celebrations, Dede Korkut epic culture, there is also Karagöz Hacivat, this year also another new ones just registered. In addition to this, Turkey has also started to recognize living cultural treasures, like in China, Korea, and Japan. The traditional sohbet meetings in the UNESCO representative list of intangible cultural heritage of humanity. In 2009, when we get together in Washington, Smithsonian to analyze intangible cultural heritage convention, safeguarding intangible cultural heritage conventions from the Turkey point of view, how convention contributes to community. I compared UNESCO and UNESCO free communities, how a convention affects the traditional practices. If their elements are registered, how is the outcome? If their elements are not registered, how is the outcome? So I compared. So Urfa is actually, they sustain their tradition incredibly successfully, and local people are actually quite aware of their own cultural elements, and they are activists, and there's really important initiations towards the Sıragecesi at that time, and they registered the elements, and we thought, as free, you know, like ethnomusicologists, you don't need to interfere that culture because by themselves they sustain their culture. So this is one of the example of their traditional practice. I want to put here as a positive example, but there are also different views about if the elements are registered, there are also negative effects of the culture. You know, like it becomes very touristic. They began to sell the Sıra geceleri for 500 euro per night, stuff like that. So having strong local administrations is important. Having strong local administrations surrounded by folklorist tradition bearers and large number of cultural volunteers has a strong impact on actions towards attempts aimed at cultural safeguarding. The realization of the commercialized version of Sıra gece the realization of the commercialized version of Sıra Gecesi energized all cultural stakeholders in the region. The Şanlıurfa Metropolitan Municipality started to implement action plans which formed the infrastructure for a city of music to be achieved through several projects. One of these was the establishment of the Şanlıurfa Conservatory Branch Directorate in 2018, made in accordance with the stated aim of UNESCO 2003 Convention, Article 1. What happens in non-sustainable environment, non-stable environment? So as you all know, after this we will play. So as you all witnessed, unfortunately we had an incredible tragic event in Turkey. The initial 7.8 magnitude earthquake shook the ground as far away as Egypt. More than 52,000 people, we never know the real numbers, were killed instantly on February 6, 2023. 11 of the 17 provinces in Turkey's south were declared disaster zones. At least 4 million buildings were damaged or destroyed. Hatay province sustained the most severe damage. So what we are going to watch after the slides, I think, is somebody going to play? Yeah, I will just briefly explain what we are going to vote. After the earthquake, can you hold a little bit? Thank you, Gökçen. So until now, we talk about the stable environment when everything goes right, you know, like not so right, but when we don't have a war in our country, when we don't have natural disasters, so we know where to go, how to work. But when there is an extreme event, disasters, things are really from the root changes. And then you have to start, you have to think about system reset. So we actually came to that point after that. My connection with Hatay started in 2017 when I was asked to establish conservatory in Hatay, Antioch. From ITU, I went to Hatay to set up Turkish music program in Hatay Mustafa Kemal University. And we started education in Turkish music program in 2018. We accepted our first students in 2018. And we gave our first graduate students 2022. August, I'm right, yeah, to sometimes last year I'm saying, 2022 August. Then after that, in February 2023, earthquake happened. Just after 23 August, I resigned from the university because my life is, I have been traveling between Istanbul and Hatay. It has been very, very difficult time for me for the last 7 years. During earthquake, my students and my colleagues and everybody we know, of course, try to reach us. That's a devastating event. Also made me think, what can I do for my students? What else I can do? So the music you are going to listen is one of the singer from Hatay. Also, right now, one of our teachers in our center, Culture for Sustainability Center in Istanbul. So through the events, she composed this song. So maybe we can listen now. After that, I will explain. Not from the PowerPoint, but from the song itself, please. Yeah, the right one. Can I turn the volume up a little bit?
Thank you.
Thank you. Ma, Rehna, Rehna, home is, we didn't go, we are here. Many mothers, you know, lost their children, and for especially for the first couple of days of the first hit, they couldn't get any help, and they began to walk on the streets with this lyric in Arabic, and the she is Selin Sümbültepe is singing, and she wrote the song. It's an ode. She lost also her both parents, so when she was really burning in her heart, she wrote this song. And first time they published this on the first anniversary of the earthquake, 7th of February this year. So how did the earthquake affect the sustainability of music practices in Hatay? With a natural disaster, all support structures for music disappear. Virtually every building was destroyed, communities were dispersed. People focused on primary means of survival. Live music performance disappeared, online music was limited, instrument makers and other support structures disappeared. Several applied ethnomusicologists have researched music practices after natural or man-made disasters and developed models and ways of working that best serve the affected communities. The literature and document review revealed four broad categories of intentions or stated goals that underpin many music interventions in conflict-affected settings. Music education, cultural regeneration, social development, healing, health and well-being. So I will try to show some of the intentions and ongoing strategies of NGO called MIRAS in a post-earthquake zone in Hatay. So after earthquake, we established, we established a Center for Cultural Sustainability called MIRAS Heritage. It's a non-profit organization. The reason we needed to set up this organization is to be able to help directly to the community, because I was affiliated with the culture. And all the experts we are working with over the years, I was actively involved with academia in the university. I'm still working there, but also I want to be free from the government and entity, so I can also act as an association and NGO. So it was around March, or actually it became effective in May legally. We became a legal entity. We have in our team, we have many different backgrounds, from lawyers to neurologists, ethnomusicologists. We have so many international experts from all over the world who's expert in sustainability. And our aim is to create create motivation with the people we have in Istanbul or all over the world to help Hatay to sustain their traditional music and traditional cultural practices. Especially we are working with the musicians from Hatay. So when we go to Hatay, we also give workshops in primary schools, secondary schools, and we are trying to reach also adults in container villages. So we came, one of our project called SOS. SOS project has long-term music activities in for four target groups, for children, adolescents in schools and containers and container villages, and the elderly in aged care facilities. The person, Asim Kuzuluk, he's specialized in Barak türküleri, Barak folk music. He's from Hatay. We are collaborating with him also. They need more than one of entertainment, of course. The people in Hatay, they need to see that helps and teachers and social activities more than one time. So it's very difficult to continue to sustain our activities, but we are trying to find many different ways. And one of them, actually, we collaborated with the Ministry of National Education Directorate of Hatay. So we can, as NGO, as Miras, we can work with many different schools legally, at, you know, confirmed by the local governments. And we aim education, research studies, cultural sustainability and well-being, four different area. There are some instrument makers in different villages, Kırıkan, I don't know if anybody knows Hatay. Unfortunately, their profession was affected badly because many instrument stores also disappeared, you know, they collapsed. And he was making instrument bağlama, and if there is no customers, he won't sell any bağlama. So Ahmet Usta's job is in danger of disappearing. So I'm trying to reach many people. If anybody needs bağlama, please reach out Ahmet Usta and order bağlama. And there are also many young musicians from conservatory, from fine arts high school, also from the music industry working there, or venue halls, you know, the restaurant halls, owners. There is absolutely nothing left in Antioch. Not even standing building, and there are life outside of Antioch, Hatay, Seriol especially, is where many people are living. Our students after after May began to think about, you know, to think a little bit, because as a musician, musicians are musicianship is incredibly difficult profession in times of disasters. So if they sing, they feel guilty. Should I, how can I sing now? Because people, this is an entertainment. And we have been talking with them to understand their psychology. Also people are, you know, in the recovery process at the moment. And so we started online programs to talk about musicians scattered around country. What are they doing? What do they need? And also, as Miras, we are going to organize ICTM, the Applied Ethnomusicology Conference, with the collaboration of Sacred Music in next October. There are, this is also international academia is going to come to Istanbul. As Miras, we are organizing this. And sorry. For example, this support platform for Hatay musicians brought so much, I mean, it was quite effective. It was our online, on Instagram, Miras's Instagram account. We reach out many musicians and they share their feelings and they share their needs. So many people from different profession or different cities can also contact with them. You know, we give chance to people to tell their needs, and we try to also provide their wishes. So on the 8th of March, as you know, we talk about Women's Day, Women Rights. And we always try to emphasize the subjects on Hatay, how women situations are in Hatay and what else we can do. So this is the bağlama maker Ahmet Usta on the left side up, and this is the next international conference we are going to host in Istanbul. It is Applied Ethnomusicology and Sacred Spiritual Music. There are many things, many different areas we are trying to be active, and in a way, when there is no stability in a country, how applied ethnomusicology projects can work. In a way, we are also trying to find the best way to be more useful. So I'm going to show a little video. We went to Yayla Dağı Village, Bezge Köyü, Bezge Village, Bezge İlköğretim Okulu Primary School, and we went to Meydan Village last month, and art, music, dance and rhythm workshops we are doing with the little kids in the primary school, and this is the little example of that workshop. If anybody can play the video, Gökçe Hanım is there? Okay. It's a 1 minute video. can you switch on PowerPoint? Okay. We have tried to show that applied work in the study of music in Turkey goes back 100 years and continues to be highly relevant in initiatives such as MIRAS, which strives to use the national and international experience in working with communities to benefit the people affected by the earthquake, to improve their sense of community, regain a sense of well-being after great suffering and reconnect to their sense of place. So it was all from my side. Thank you very much for listening. For anybody who wants to read more, especially about the model and this, it's published by Oxford University Press, Music Community Sustainability, my chapter in there. And also I have a couple of more about music in higher education where I am working.
Thank you very much for the inspiring talk and all the work that you are doing. Quite impressive, honestly. We would like to open up the floor for the Q&A session now, if you have any questions.
Which procession was this first video clip? Was procession? And it was this girl sing this beautiful song. What kind of procession was this?
It was a protest.
Protest.
After, so 1 year, after, we go back to Hatay all the construction. We go back to Hatay all the time, and we see that the progress in restoring Hatay is very, very painfully slow. And there's a strong feeling amongst the people of Hatay, who are very proud to be from there, and who don't want to leave their place, that there is a concerted effort to keep them away from that. We have a house there, and it is so difficult to keep your house and to have it restored. We've got a beautiful old Ottoman house there, and if Olga hadn't been as clever as she is, it would have been destroyed by now. There was no water, no electricity in the entire center for the entire year. So there's a lot of voices saying something needs to happen in Hatay in order to restore it to its old glory, because surely over time the buildings will be restored. But the reason why we started MIRAS is that we think that there is a rebuilding beyond bricks that you need, a rebuilding of community, a rebuilding of culture, of being proud of where you're from. So. And there's a lot of work to be done in that area, and sometimes
it is very difficult to understand the situation from outside. Even people in Istanbul, Ankara, Izmir, dating life is still, you know, life is normal now because they can't see on the media anymore. It's not on the news anymore. But when you go back to Antioch, it is really not no development whatsoever. Still in the mud, there is no electricity after 6 o'clock. There is an incredible high level of litter. We got burgled many times, and you can't prevent this. But people from Hatay, you don't have to be from Hatay. Like I don't have any relation whatsoever with Hatay until I started working there. But when you see the pain and incredible, how can I describe the feel? You know, they lost everything and they need help. And they were once had so many properties and rich and academical profession, you know, life sometimes shakes us to remind us that you are nothing and you can be nothing. And in the time of these difficulties, and people need to really stubborn and stable to continue helping those who need help. We should really not have luxury to forget people. And I know there are so many disasters, so many bad things happening in the world, but in Hatay, every time you go back, there are so many things to do, so many things to that we should really be loud and help. And the people are so decisive. People from Hatay, they say only people from Hatay will revitalize this town, because people from outside they see like us outsider, cannot continue, cannot do anything so much because we are living in Istanbul, we come and go, but we are trying to create awareness and we are trying to reach people with whatever we can do with our expertise and as people, as just human. So because I know some people and I have some knowledge of how to continue intangible culture heritage, sustainability, whatever, and we can also reach international organizations and let people know how, what happened, you know, people even don't know where Hatay is. Even coming here to talk about this is also impact. But the reason they say we are not going anywhere, we didn't go anywhere, but sometimes the local governments are saying that circumstances are incredibly difficult, so you have to leave, you know. But they don't want to leave because at the moment they go, looters are coming in. So they don't want to lose their territory, their shop, whatever they have left. So they are willing to live in the tents, in the mats. So there are some high school, fine arts students right now living in the tents, and their mother and father, whoever left in the family, and their teachers, over the night they wait until morning so they can sleep in the tent. But the tent is incredibly unhealthy, and sometimes rains and the cold, and during the daytime they go to their container and they try to learn music. And for example, the first slide I showed, Karsu is there. It was a first opening ceremony from Serignol LLA Association Music Community Music House, and they, with incredible effort, they collected music instruments from Amsterdam. People donated many instruments, and they, Karsu's mother and father collected all of them, and they brought from Amsterdam to Hatay. And they provided music instruments for the children. There is, like right now, 1,000 children registered to that music school. They want to learn, they want to continue their life. They want to be normalize their life. But still, there are so many, you know, we are hearing the instruments are broken and they need to find some repairman. I have a donor wants to donate her piano from Istanbul. I don't have a logistic to send the piano to Hatay. So we need so many things to help each other. So what we are talking like applied ethnomusicology, applied ethnomusicology is here to be able to help for sustaining cultures. So without, if I could have been somebody from UNESCO. So if you are somebody from UNESCO, you also have different ways to reach to that end. If you are a non-academic person, as a tradition bearer, you also have a role in the society. So you can also contribute from that sense. When I was trying to show the model for Domenic area, I tried to show from everybody's perspective. If you are academic, you can do this, you can do that. If you are working in the municipality, you can start from your own local authority and reach other people. And we talk about problems and solutions. And as you know, academic people and also as human, we are trying to share our thoughts so we can collaborate with each other and help to others. So this seminar was about that. I hope you enjoyed, and I hope you also touch each other after this evening.
Any other questions?
Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for the great work you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Are there any other questions? Yes.
Just what I see here in London, street music. You can encourage street music there. Mm-hmm. You don't need to make concert and airplanes. Musician can go to the street and then collect some money. So
in Hatay, it's a bit difficult.
Everywhere.
We have no streets left.
There is no streets, no people. The environment, that's why there are some musicians left. If only I can give some interviews, but I had to translate, of course. But outside of the city there are some musicians and singing in the cafes, but the population is less right now, and people are coming to cafe at night, maybe a couple of days in a week, and what do they earn is not enough to look after the families. And many people also went to Antalya, tourism areas. Many people left Hatay. But you know, we can. I think being a street musician is a good idea, but in different cities, maybe it will work. For some of them, it will work.
Any other questions? Yes.
I guess this is about your research long before the Hatay disaster, when you were looking at traditional dances that were performed by men as opposed to the ones performed by women. Did you make much progress in that area?
We did actually, especially in introverted society like Dominic, our elderly aunties, age elderly people host the traditional heritage. Because young people left out migration affected area, so first they were incredibly shy to even share their knowledge. Then when they trust you and they began to show, they began to sing, because of also religious thoughts, restrictions in religion, it prevents them to sing. So it was a big barrier for me to understand and to record many things. But at the end, some of them are really nomadic villages. Those ladies also, actually they hold very important information about the real traditional nomadic songs. So I arrange actually house gatherings with them. I recorded the songs and we did dance, and some of them with a couple of months begging, they accepted to come to Istanbul. And some of them taught to our ITU folk dance students their own dances, so we recorded. But on apart from that recording and safeguarding projects, I established association in that region.
Sure. The question was about men.
Men or women, I understand.
It was actually the fact that, you know, in cultural anthropology, for over a century, there's been a need for female anthropologists to do exactly this kind of work on every single possible level, because women's history has been erased by the fact that male academics who go into an area, they can't learn anything because the women won't be able to speak to them.
Yes, gender discrimination issues everywhere, especially in the Anatolian villages.
This is why it's so important to bring more women into cultural anthropology and ethnomusicology, because these things will be lost forever unless there's the researchers that can go in and learn from the inside source.
Yes,
I'm very grateful that for your work.
Ulca had an added advantage that she comes from the area, so that's
exactly
through her family.
Because I knew, also, you have to, I mean, really, it's a big effort from the researchers. You have to live in there, you have to, you know, separate some time of your life, and you have to understand what they are watching. So I figured out they are watching a specific TV channel called Vision Turk.
Sure.
I had no idea. And I learned where is the center of this Vision Turk TV channel, and I learned it was in Istanbul, and I spoke with the production manager. I asked if we can also film a specific documentary for Dominic traditional music and dances, and we convinced some of the villagers. We brought them from Dominic to Istanbul. We made a completed Dominic culture program. So because whole region, not age inside of Turkey, is watching Vision Turk. So you have, there are some details when you do research, you have to pin, you know, you have to figure out what is going on in the societies, the, you know, social research, field work is very important. So the similar kind of projects I created, and I believe it motivated some of the local villagers to continue and to, you know, to be more courageous about speaking out, and singing is not very bad.
Sure.
But of course, who are we that we are claiming that I did this, you know, thanks to me that your culture is being saved? Of course, we can't say this. If it is going to be disappeared, it is going to be disappeared.
Sure. But I mean, one of the points that you made in one of your writings was that it was easier for you to learn the men's dances because you could see them from inside the house and they were performed outside than the women's dances, which were performed in private sessions.
Yes.
And so that's why your research is so important.
Oh, thank you. It's so good to hear for me. Thank you so much.
Behind you, there was a question, another question.
Yes, I wasn't sure that to ask this question. If it doesn't seem a meaningful question, just set aside. But early in the first presentation that you gave, you said, well, we don't hear about, or it won't ever be reported that a person has died of music deprivation. To me, it makes good sense that people might die of music deprivation, and I wondered if you could tell us a bit more what your understanding of music deprivation is. I can well understand that the instrument maker has intense music deprivation in the film because he or she can no longer make the instrument, but in maybe a wider sense, how does music deprivation impact on our lives?
I doubt if there's a lot of research about this. I used the example of music deprivation to make clear of how naturally we accept that music is part of our lives and how rarely we see the absence of it as a reason for us not feeling very well. And our work in Hatay is actually a very good example of where music was ripped out of people's lives. I mean, everything was ripped out of people's lives. Our Mukhtar, the person who takes care of our area, lost 67 relatives in 10 minutes. He dragged his nieces from under the rubble, hoping that he would save her, and she was dead in his arms. So we've heard and seen unspeakable pain for people. And we know that music comforts people. There's so much music. Interestingly, there's actually more music that comforts people than music that expresses joy. So we use music from very young on to very old to comfort ourselves, to feel connected to the world, to the universe, to God, to our family, to our communities. And seeing that ripped away from people is something that we feel is a real danger for the community. So I do not know of any doctor who would ever have written music deprivation as cause of death for anyone. But I think we can all understand that the deprivation of music, especially in a time that when people are suffering, makes things worse for people.
Maybe some doctors should
be. I think it's a really interesting research.
Sorry to interrupt, but we know from the from Turkey that doctors are actually, some of the doctors are actually prescribing music as a therapy to many patients, actually. This has been going on for many years, actually.
Yeah, and not only in Turkey.
In the history, in the Ottoman history, you can see where music is used as a therapy.
Yeah.
Sorry, can I ask another comment?
Sure. All right.
When I talk before.
Yeah, that's right.
Remark on what this lady said. The trees, if you give them music, they become healthy. If I came here 30 years ago, if I came here and I heard you, I would say, give them bread and water before you give them the luxury of
music. Yes, many people thought the same thing.
No, I feel music, I cannot say more important than water and bread, but if we deprive from water and bread, we die in few days. Yeah. But if we deprive of music, we die slowly. Yeah. So music is as much as important as food.
It's very important too.
Because if you educate people in music, if you encourage them to play music, you keep them away from arguments about, you know, religion and politics and all these whatever. The last word I want to say, I forgot. In Aleppo, we say in every house in Aleppo there is lute, oud. Mm-hmm. So if Arab people have instrument in every house, they are all united on music.
This is so true, yeah. Music actually, just after the earthquake, and even though it has been a year, we know that sometimes including me, I can't talk about my students that, you know, that they are not here anymore. Some people are still cannot talk about the situation because they lost everything and it is incredible traumatic situation. But when you go to Hatay in the container villages, the children, when you sing, they can state their psychology with the music and the verse. You know, they shout, they sing, and it really helps to express themselves. It's an incredible, powerful expression tool, music. So it could be in many, many different ways, many rhythmic patterns, many body also movements. It's right now, it is the best remedy of the society.
I can ask one final question. As far as I understand, there are adults and children getting involved in the project. I was wondering their interpretation of the project, how they embrace it, and how they interpret the project, and how they interpret the applied ethnomusicology aspect of it, and if you see any possibilities around in the near future to raise local ethnomusicologists who are actually raised within this project, which I think in some ways serves as a hub for such work.
Actually. Yes, actually, this is a very good question. What we set up is Antioch State Conservatory. We have a Turkish music program. Whoever graduates from this Turkish music program, of course, depending on their choice of specialization, you know, in their graduation thesis, some of them want to become ethnomusicologists. There are unfortunately not so many high academic people in our discipline in that region. But as long as people want to study, as MIRAS, we are also making announcement that, you know, they can come, and we are also actually preparing and thinking to set up a certificate program for many ethnomusicologists in the world to also train local Hatay people, whoever wants to specialize in that realm. So we have good number of people who are willing to come Hatay and Istanbul to give trainings. So like Patricia Campbell, she's Gillian Howell, they are expert in post-conflict societies and traumatic societies, and they are music professors, and they have been working with the music, with the children and with young people for many, many decades. And they want to give training programs to local music teachers in Hatay. Because there are also music teachers working and teaching to young children there, but they also are lacking knowledge how to reach out to kids. It is important and very delicate subject. In many different ways, I am thinking what else we can do as MIRAS. Young musicians look like they are ready. Whatever we need, you know, they want to take role. If it is teaching, they want to teach. And local people, like local authorities, they want to help. But the current situation is so difficult because first the city has to come up. You know, there are no buildings. People are trying to save their houses. And there are regulations changing all the time. And for us even to go Hatay is difficult because there is no direct flight to Hatay. We have to fly to Adana, and we have to rent a car from Adana to Hatay. There is no transportation, only once in a day, the one transportation. It is quite difficult to do something, but there are so many volunteers also from the day one of the earthquake working and settled in that region in Meydan village, in Meydanköy, you know, the lady. And many people also are helping, and we are trying to find each other the moment we connect, and we become bigger, we get bigger in our works.
But to come back to the question, we are trying to work as much as possible with local people. So we're not trying to fly people in, but we're trying to work with local people. And some local people just want to be good music teachers in schools, and that's fine. But because we're there, because we're mentoring people, and because we're having the discussions, I think people will grow into understanding how this works. Applied ethnologist is hardly a guarantee for fantastic income in Hatay for the next 200 years. But doing this kind of work is something that we really strongly believe in, and worldwide we see what we call community music as a very important new way of dealing with music. So it used to be that we thought about music education as what you do in universities and in conservatoires of music, and now we're seeing that many people are very successful in helping communities find their own voice in expressing themselves. And I think the work that we're doing in Hatay is not us superimposing some kind of music on the people of Hatay.
They don't have to be applied at
them. Giving them a voice themselves, and the people that will rise with the work that we're doing with Miras, which is still very small now, will show in the next 5 or 10 years who will rise and who will become the leaders of that. We would love to be able to withdraw after a while and say, you can do this by yourselves, you don't need us anymore.
Well, personally, I hope that this project grows by the time. It's actually incredible how much you, how far you have come, despite all the challenges, including infrastructure and other things. And I hope that this will go beyond non-profit, which I think is very crucial in terms of also creating job opportunities with all these musicians and people who take pride in their heritage and music in Hatay.
Thank you.
Well, I join our audience in thanking you for creating this project. We are very impressed. Thank you all very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming.
Have yourselves with Turkish refreshments today.